it was kind of difficult because each time I ate or if I drank anything, it would just get caught on the beard and the mustache. So took a little bit of getting used to, but after that, when I was done with the project and I had to shave it off, I felt like Samson. I kind of like lost a bit of that anger, that drive, that power that I had as Heilong. I was very into it. I think this is pretty much the biggest project I've ever been involved in. I put in so much work memorizing those lines, and it wasn't like the simple Chinese words or scripts that I used to work with, and this one was like every paragraph just had a cheng yi or two. And also I think back then they were more colorful with their descriptions and or with their conversations, you know. So it was pretty much like, I just want to ask you a simple question, can we go out for like to watch a movie or something? But it's pretty much like, your father knows my father who got to know your mom but then gave up your mom for my mom, and you know, it's like it's telling one whole big going one whole big round just to ask a simple question, do you want to go out for a movie? So the script wise it was really tough for me, and I realized that being the baddie, you normally have to explain your actions either to the policeman or to the hero why you shouldn't be killed or why he should actually join forces with you. That takes a really long time because you're so filled with anger, but then you know you're doing it for the sake of the audience. In case you didn't watch episode 2, episode 3, scene 1, this is what happened and now you have to die, you know. I think first and foremost the script has got to be really fluid there in terms of characters having dialogues or the interaction between one character with another. It can't be something so jarring or something so out of the blue. The way my character was written, and as actors we sometimes talk about it, everyone just felt that the acting bit of it was so effortless because the script or the lines just kind of brought the character to life. The rest didn't have to do much homework, but I had to do extra homework because it was so good that I had, there were so many feelings and emotions that were being evoked from the script. So I kind of like actually put a lot of personal experiences and feelings into the character. You know, I'm just, right now, offhand, I probably can only think of like not wanting to let your parents down. I remember my dad would always remind us of what he went through. That was during the Japanese occupation, and there was something that was very poignant for me throughout the whole show, which was this scene where I had to tell and explain to Li Nanxing's character why I am the way I am, and that was the only one time that the audience will get to see the sensitive, or I wouldn't say sensitive, but the vulnerable side of my character. And it was him having to bury his own father. And my dad actually shared with me, back then, my grandfather was kind of like beaten up, abused by the Japanese soldiers, and my dad had to bury him. We came from a very poor background, and what he did was he actually just got two planks of wood just to carry my grandfather and buried him. Well, in this show, what I did was I found my father, he was dead, and the owner of the tin mine actually said, no, your dad died of natural causes, you know, take him and get out of here. So I knew my dad worked his butt off and he died in the tin mine. So what I did was at a very tender age of 12, I wrapped my dad in one of those straw mats and I couldn't bury him, so I just threw him off a cliff. So that scene was quite emotional for me. And because we were filming overseas and because of the tight schedule, I only had maybe just 45 minutes to do that scene, and it was a whole spew of dialogue. And all Li Nanxing had to say was, why? You cannot do this. I am not going to be like you. And the rest is just me telling the whole story. So that scene was very interesting and very memorable for me. Fortunately for me, my character had already came over from China, so that bit was pretty much neglected, and they didn't have to show how my character came down from China. And my character came down as a small boy. So the beginning of the show was how they came from China, and some of them had to go back to China. So my part of the story only came out in like Ep 6. Well, firstly, we don't have to travel to that many locations. This time around, because this blockbuster happens to be a Niantai piece, so Kutai, there are a lot of things that you cannot show, obviously, in Singapore. And in Singapore, a lot of things are modernized. So we actually went all the way to Malaysia and we went to China. So the difference would be, firstly, you don't have to travel to that many places. This time round, the scenery actually took precedence. A lot of things were very dependent on the location. I think what really made this a blockbuster, the difference of this would be, first, the emphasis on the script. It's not very often a good script comes along. A lot of research went into this. And what makes it different from a modern day show, I think we always heard stories, about how our grandfather, how our ancestors came to Singapore and what they went through. But this is us living it and telling the story for everyone to see. Whereas a modern day show, it's pretty much, you and I both know that, in this day and age, just Facebook, you can always find a friend if you want to. But back then it was like snail mail. A lot of people couldn't really get up to where they want to be because it's pretty much who you know. And right now is who knows you, but back then is who do you know that can actually help you. So back then a lot of things were really difficult. I mean, just traveling from one place to another, sleeping in the houses also, there was no air condition. So we actually lived the life, we actually walked in the shoes of these immigrants. So I think us living it and having to tell the story is very different from us doing a modern day show where everyone knows what you're going through and everybody knows the story. So there's how many different ways can you tell a story that you're living right now? But when we told a story of the past, something that's very historic, it's up to everyone's interpretation and we have to follow the script. And the script is so well written, everything just flowed like water. Everything was so tough back then, and the only thing that was on everyone's mind was just survival, and also filial piety was really big. Anything your parents say, you just got to follow. There's no such thing as right now, Dad, I don't want to do this, Back then, I remember, I think I still kind of lived through it. Was when my dad passed me on to my teacher in school, there's no such thing as, hey, I don't want to do this. You go and tell my dad, My dad will support me. I tell you, back then, if my teacher had just made a phone call back home, you won't see me at home, man. I don't even want to go home because I'd rather stay in school. I'd rather be in jail than to go back home. Right now, it's like the parents are just, pretty much giving the kids too much leeway or giving them too much respect, I think.